This conference will now be recorded.
Oh, there you go.
Everybody's so quiet. Need to have some music or something going on here, Casey.
Are you going to start singing, John?
Yeah, well, got a little sobering events happening in DC, so I've been tuned into that all day long.
Very sobering.
Yeah.
It's horrifying and disgusting.
Yeah.
Casey, I have 6 o'clock. So I'm ready to start if you guys are.
I do as well.
Very good. Well, good evening, everyone, and thank you for attending the Board of Supervisors workshop meeting of January the 6th, 2021. To start the meeting, will you please stand with me if you can and join in saying the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, to the Republic which stands under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I'm going to say that takes on a lot of meaning today for me.
I agree, John. I completely agree.
Well, thank you, everyone, for that. Just to echo those thoughts, it is very important on a day like this. Just some brief housekeeping notes. Please be aware this teleconference is being recorded using GoToMeeting. So we can have as smooth a meeting as possible. Please, can you, if you're a member of the public and you're just in listening, please can you mute yourself, or Casey, can you mute those folks so that we eliminate background noise? For the workshop agenda items, board members will discuss the topic first, followed by the opportunity for public comment. And there is also an open public comment period at the end of the agenda. And when you wish to speak, if you could please address the meeting chair, which is myself, requesting that you would like to comment and announce your name. Before, Susan, I'm sorry, I'm going to put you on ice here for just a second. Before we begin with the first agenda item, I would like to revisit an open item that we had at our township reorganization meeting held on Monday this week. Margie, I believe she's on the call, I see her name. Margie Swart raised a question whether in the light of the $1 million grant received by Fame Fire Company, if the board wanted to still proceed with the $10,000 donation that was planned in the 2021 general fund budget. Unfortunately, I got distracted by additional conversation and I failed to ask if any of the board wished to address her question. So therefore, I would like now to give the board members the opportunity to weigh in and discuss your views and whether they have changed on this planned donation. So open it up for your thoughts.
I have the background there for you, Sean. This is Hugh.
Go ahead, Hugh.
I talked to the president of the fire company today, and they are having a meeting tomorrow to review everything that they have. Obviously, the $1 million isn't in the bag yet. They know that their total expenses are in excess of $1 million. I suggested to him would it be feasible at all if we could defer at least our contribution until next year? He said that would be something to consider. As I said, he's having a meeting tomorrow night to review it because they don't even know exactly what they're getting. So Billy Renane, who gave us the presentation initially, a couple of months ago, he said he would get him to get back to us. So at this point, it's in a state of flux, but he indicated that they probably would still need it, but they could possibly defer it for a year.
So Hugh, are you suggesting at this point the board consider just putting a hold on this until we have more clarity and perhaps have another presentation from FAME in a month or so?
Correct.
Okay, other board members, Ashley, your thoughts?
So I was obviously not in favor of giving any funds to FAME this year from the beginning. And because I know that they are well funded, the board decided to give them 10,000. Okay, I'm talking. The board decided to give them $10,000 from Goshen's allocation, which I was not in favor of, to take back $10,000 that we now have allocated to FAME Fire Company, I think is just bad practice. I'm not one to say that you should rescind, funds for a fire company, but I do think that other fire companies could use that money. And so rather than, guarding our own pride, maybe we should take back the 10,000 and give it to someone who actually needs it. And I'm not in favor of deferring the payment because I think that if they've gotten a $1 million grant, they're pretty good and they should be good for a while and they should make it work like the other fire companies have been doing.
Okay, John.
Well, my feeling on it is what we had originally discussed about not pursuing the excavator for public works and the third police vehicle for the police department, and instead use those funds to contribute towards the Goshen Volunteer and also Good Fellowship. I think we're pretty much okay with that, but then when the final budget decision was made, following Hugh's request for the 10,000 for FAME, we moved 10,000 from Goshen Volunteer towards FAME, towards their capital budget. So considering the fact that now they have this $1 million grant, assuming it does come through, and that's an assumption according to what Hugh just told us tonight, I would feel comfortable in moving back that $10,000 towards Goshen Volunteer Fire Company. Not only because they asked for it, but because this was an extraordinary year we just got through. They had to cancel the Goshen Fire Fair, which is a big money maker for them because of COVID. And they should not have to handle that this year, I hope. So they should be able to have the fair. So they should not be in as bad a shape financially next year this time as they are right now. So I think they would be in more need of the $10,000 at this time. But again, I'm going to say whatever contribution we make as a township needs to be revisited in its entirety this time next year, and have these fire companies come to us and justify whatever monetary requests they might make. But at this time, I would feel okay with deferring this for a while till we hear back from FAME. But my inclination would be to move that $10,000 towards a more needy recipient, which in this case would be the volunteer, or Goshen volunteer.
If I can add a little bit there, Sean.
Yeah, go ahead, Hugh.
In answer to, first of all, you need to look at the total financial picture of the various organizations. FAME does not, we'll start with Goshen. Goshen has a substantial reserve at this point, although their income was definitely knocked off this last year and will be reduced probably this year too. They certainly can survive it for the 2 years. The long-term picture of Goshen is that they are definitely going to need additional support, which they've asked for. FAME's situation is that they're working on the brink right now. They don't have substantial reserves like Goshen does. Good Fellowship, who's the other one in our emergency group, is in the same boat. They don't have substantial reserves. They're working pretty much hand to mouth too. So if they're going to transfer money, it shouldn't be to Goshen. It probably should be to either GFAC or FAME. We haven't even considered the other two fire companies that service us, and that's Goodwill and First Westchester.
Okay, thanks, Hugh. My thoughts are we have a commitment through a contract with Westchester Fire Company, which was a substantial part of our contributions to volunteer fire organizations and the ambulance companies. Presumably, they use that standing commitment to appropriately budget for their expenses and their other revenues. The FAME Fire Company was a decision they made to invest capital in a substantial project. They talked about $800,000 of debt, I believe, in their presentation. So this is a capital commitment they've made to raising funds to do it, to take on debt where there was a shortfall. And although they hadn't achieved their funding goals, that was the reason they came, as we remember, was an 11th hour request to fund something from our budget to them. We, as John said, decided that it would be taken from our contribution to Goshen, which they had requested of us, given their funding issues this year. So all things considered, I am more on the line of the page of John, which is that we are willing to hear what FAME has to say and why they are more meritorious of having a contribution to their capital debt repayment, if you like, because that's presumably what it would be used for, or funding the remaining part of their project. But at the same time, I feel that if we decide that that is not something they need, given $1 million, which is new information in terms of a grant that they didn't have when they came with their initial request, if that does assume pan out, then I would like to consider whether, you know, this Goshen payment, Goshen Volunteer Fire Company payment for 2021 is still reasonable given their funding shortfalls. And as John said, we would revisit it when we got to a 2022 budget process. So I would suggest for tonight that we simply put a hold on that $10,000 payment and ask that FAME Fire Company come back with the information around their grant and their project for the board to reconsider whether it should be paid or not in a month or so when they have more information. Is that reasonable to the other board members?
That's fine with me.
That sounds okay, too.
So one thing, Sean, I'd want to correct you, or at least clarify something. You said the Westchester Fire Department. The fire department consists of three companies. They're structured a little different. The borough itself owns the apparatus. They own the trucks, and the contract that we have with the borough is for the apparatus. It's not for operating expenses particularly. We do, the borough does pay for their gasoline. Excuse me, but I'm sorry. Anyhow, the borough does pay for some operating expenses, but very minimal. The fire companies themselves cover a lot of their operating and all of their building expenses. So just in the way of explanation.
Thank you, Hugh. That was a good point. Thank you. Ashley, you okay waiting?
I'm okay waiting. I think that's fine if that's the way we want to go. I don't really see the point of having FAME come back to us at this point. I feel like they've already sort of made their presentation of why they want the money. And I feel like at this point, they're just, especially if the grant comes through at $1 million, I mean, they might be able to make a case of why, you know, they would want an extra 10,000. But at this point, I feel like it's all to pay back their debt. And my point is, you know, I'll do whatever you guys want to do, but I don't want to waste our agenda time or their time having to come back and give us the same presentation twice. So I'm fine with waiting though.
Okay, well, let's leave it that we'll just put a hold on the payment and that we will look for some either confirmation of receipt of the grant, which Hugh, just to test with you, I presume that will absolutely lower their debt payment that they've taken on. So it will reduce their cash operating costs in as soon as they've received the money. Assuming that's a true statement, then as Ashley points out, maybe it isn't another presentation, rather it's just a final decision by this board as to whether we give them money or whether we consider a Goshen Fire as the alternative. Would you agree with that, Hugh?
Yeah, that's my understanding at this point.
Okay. So I don't know if Robin's on the line yet. Casey, do you know if she joined? I don't see her.
I do not see her, but let me unmute. Caller number 5 was late. Robin, are you on the line?
I am.
Okay, very good. You were caller number 5. Let me update your info.
Did you hear the conversation there, Robin?
I heard all of it, yes. And I had you have on mute because I was in the gondola, so I can now speak more freely.
Okay,
sorry.
So
are
you okay with
share?
The approach?
Yes, I think that's a good approach, and I think the only thing that we'd want to do is just have, if it's not going to be a presentation, which I agree with Ashley, I don't think we need to go through that, but I do think it'd be useful to have you and Ashley as the board chairs to just have a conversation with them and, you know, basically evaluate what's going to happen going forward. And I'm fairly certain that they probably would recognize the reason why we might want to rescind our contribution this year.
Okay. Thank you, Robin. Are there any public comments on this discussion?
Hi, it's Margie.
Go ahead, Margie.
Just a quick thank you for revisiting it. Appreciate it. And you talked it through, so I think you talked it through well. So that's all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you. Very good. So agenda item number 3. Tree City USA designation for West Goshen Township. Susan, I don't know if you're presenting something or just having a conversation with us tonight. So over to you.
Thank you. I don't know if, I could share some screenshots at some point, but I don't know how to do that. It's not necessary.
Why don't you just talk to us, Susan, and we'll hopefully get the gist of it. And if we need more information, you can share a document with us or whatever.
Okay. Thank you. And thank you to Ashley for suggesting that I present this to you. So I'm On behalf of the Sustainability Advisory Committee, I'm here to request that you approve moving forward with the township's tree city application this year. So I'll just go through. I'm sure that many of you are familiar with Tree City, but I'll just give a quick summary of what it is. It's Tree City USA is a program of the Arbor Day Foundation. It's a nationwide program, and it's basically a recognition of a community's commitment to trees as a community asset. It's a badge of pride, basically. It also provides standards and a method of accountability for taking care of the community's trees. And I'm sure you're aware that our neighbor Westchester Borough has been a tree city for 31 years. The first township in Chester County to be named a tree city is London Grove Township. And they were they achieved that recognition in 2020, last year. Have a couple of notes here on my other slide. In Pennsylvania, 27.54% of the state lives in a tree city community. There are 112 tree city communities in the state. The longest running Pennsylvania community is Upper Marion Township, which is 44 years, and Philadelphia, the city of Philadelphia, also 44 years. So the average dollars spent on trees for the community per capita is $6.57. That's an important number. Just keep that in mind as I go through the rest of these. I'm sure I don't have to tell you what trees are important for, but I am anyway going to tell you how important trees are, because that's why we're here. Trees are important. You can tell me. Beauty. Trees beautify our community. They increase our community's pride, and in that way, they also increase the value of property and the attractiveness of our community to businesses and to visitors. And they have direct impact on our climate. So that's they're very important for sustainability, and that's one reason that the Sustainability Committee is pursuing this request. Trees, for example, reduce energy costs by shading our streets. They clean the air. They store carbon, reducing greenhouse gases. They also reduce flooding, reduce erosion, and stormwater damages. So they reduce costs and, of course, increase the sustainability of our waterways and our soil. And generally, they improve the well-being of residents. People generally feel better when they're surrounded by trees. They, as I say, increase property values, demonstrably increase property values, not only for the for houses near trees, but just having a percentage, having a large percentage of your community have a shaded tree canopy increases property values. And they provide habitat for birds and other wildlife. And they're also a link to history. In our township, we have some very important heritage trees, including the weeping beech tree that was planted approximately 1703. And there's a number of very old, large oak trees. And Joseph Trimble Rothrock, one of my heroes, is buried in West Goshen in Oakland Cemetery. So just generally, Tree City takes all those benefits of trees and establishes standards of care and accountability for meeting those standards. There's, in order to become a Tree City, there's four standards that you have to meet in your application. So I'll go through that quickly. The first standard is that the community has to have a tree board or department. Somebody, the way they put it is, someone must be legally responsible for the care of all trees on township-owned property. So that's not all trees in the township, it's all trees on township-owned property. that that includes trees that are in township maintained property, in other words, the right of ways. So do we fit that requirement now? Well, it depends. West Goshen now has no tree board, of course, but a tree board under the Tree City standards can be assigned to another board, for example, the Sustainability Advisory Committee, the Park and Rec Board. It can be assigned to a manager, the township manager, or another staff member. You could create a new board. The new board could be composed of newly appointed representatives, or it could be composed of representatives of existing citizen boards, staff members, or it could be some other mechanism. So there are a lot of options for meeting that standard one. The key thing is that somebody must be responsible for the care of trees, and the board typically promulgates standards for care and maintenance of trees. Stop me if you have any questions, by the way, or I can answer questions at the end.
You're doing great, thank you.
Okay. Standard two is a tree care ordinance, and the tree care ordinance relates again to trees in public parks and public property and street trees in the public right of way. They do provide a model ordinance, but it's also stated that the ordinance has to be tailored to the individual needs of the community. So the model is a model. So where's West Goshen now? Most of the requirements in the model ordinance are included in our existing ordinances. Those could be moved to a standalone tree ordinance. There is one, in my quick review of the existing ordinances, it appears that there's at least one missing, and one that one is that there's apparently no protection for trees on public property, unless I missed it. The suggested tree ordinance language from the Arbor Day Foundation is something like, it shall be unlawful for any person, firm, or corporation to damage, remove, or cause the damage or removal of a tree on public property. So that seems fairly innocuous, but I didn't see it in our existing ordinance. The third standard is a community forestry program with an annual budget of at least $2 per capita. So $2 per capita. Within the budget, current budget of West Goshen. So I'm looking at the 2019 estimated population of West Goshen, which was 22,973. So the dollar requirement would be $45,946, approximately $46,000. So that budget, the budget can be cobbled together from staff time. It can include volunteer hours. It can include materials and equipment, and it's for the planting, care, and maintenance of trees, again, on public property. And that could include street tree care of trees and maintenance, not only in the parks, but also in right of way. And it apparently can include the Christmas tree pickup, for example. There are a lot of little items that can be included in this. So with Ashley's help, I did gather some information, and it this as of, I guess, 2020, the estimated staff time on tree care was 43,072. And we had an estimated value of materials, equipment, and contractors, which included a chipper, of about 21,680. And there were also volunteer hours. You know, West Goshen has a group of tree tenders, and full disclosure, I'm one of those who are volunteers and arrange tree plantings in the parks. So, and education and maintenance of those trees. Education of the public on the trees, on maintenance of trees. So the estimated volunteer hours for 2020 was 2,162, and the total estimate was 66,914, which is more than the $2 per capita. You may recall that I mentioned that in Pennsylvania, the average was $6 and change per capita. So that is something to keep in mind, that although we may meet that $2 per capita in 2020, there may be more we can do for trees. And the final standard is probably the easiest one to meet. That's the Arbor Day proclamation and observance. You have to proclaim Arbor Day and observe it. And there are many ways to observe it, especially in these times of COVID. There are options for virtual Arbor Day celebrations. It doesn't have to be a public gathering. This would require that we proclaim Arbor Day and observe it in 2021. I do want to point out, and there's a little history here on the Tree City, as many of you, if not all of you know, in 2018, the Board of Supervisors did authorize application for Tree City. And we did have an Arbor Day tree planting. I believe all of the supervisors attended that. And there was a proclamation issued, but we didn't, there wasn't an authorized, we didn't go forward on that application, but we do have experience with Arbor Day, and it was a very successful one. I think we could certainly arrange to do that again in 2020. That is, as I say, it's usually the easiest one to accomplish. So as far, there are four standards, and West Goshen can meet all of them if we were to submit an application. We also have, as part of the application, once you meet all, if you meet all the standards, part of the application is that your ordinance, for example, and your budget is reviewed by, the whole application is reviewed by the Pennsylvania Urban Forestry Coordinator, who is a staff member of the DCNR. Department of Conservation and Natural Resources. There's no cost, there's no fee for applying for Tree City. The only cost that would be associated with this application would be the solicitor's review of any ordinance. Every year there's a renewal. The application is renewed and you have to meet those four standards again. But again, there's no fee. So, again, and I mentioned that London Grove is the newest Tree City community. I have been in touch with London Grove, and they're very happy to assist with the application, having been through it recently. And I'm sure Westchester Borough would be happy to. I suspect they would be open to helping us also with the application. So again, I would like to ask you to approve moving forward with the application for Tree City as led by the Sustainability Advisory Committee. And then, are there any questions?
If I can offer a comment, in that 2018 application that we did, I was 100% behind that, having been a member of the Arbor Day Society for over 40 years. I don't know that we haven't done that. I would like to ask, is Ms. Alexander still involved in the organization?
My understanding is she's still part of the West Goshen Tree Tenders. But I don't know if she's involved with that particular organization you just mentioned.
The Arbor Day?
Yeah.
I think if you're asking...
Yeah, she was.
She was involved with the... Yes, she was involved with the original Arbor Day planting.
Right.
And she is still involved.
She was spearheading the tree committee for us being recognized.
Okay, Thanks, Hugh. Susan, I have a question. Is there a proposal that we don't need to form a new tree board, but in fact that the sustainability committee would perform the responsibilities of having a tree board and be meet the requirements of the standard number one? Is that correct?
I believe, yes, that's an option. I'm not necessarily saying that that's the option you should choose. We might want to discuss options and you can decide, but yes, it just needs to be a constituted board or a staff member that is responsible for deciding what the standards are for planting and care of trees in public property.
Yeah, okay. if I could
go
just
ahead,
sorry, yeah, I just want to follow up on what Susan just answered for you, Sean. It is sort of a, I don't want to say it's a complicated issue, but for example, I've been talking, you know, the sustainability committee has been talking with Casey and Derek, and you know, the Tree City USA people say, well, maybe, you know, some people have an arborist, like a full-time arborist that they use, and we don't have that. We contract that out, right? We have an arborist that we need who can perform those duties when we need it. But I think the part that gets me about this standard is the legally responsible part. I wouldn't want to. So I know we used to have a shade tree commission, and I know that technically the sustainability could probably, we never had a shade tree commission, never. Oh, interesting, okay, sorry about that. All right, we never had a shade tree. The point is the sustainability committee could function as kind of what you're talking about to meet the standard. But we do contract a lot of our tree maintenance work out, and I presume that it would more likely be like parks.
Okay.
That would kind of meet that. I mean,
so our board could be this sustainability committee, so we don't have to form a new board, but we could have a township staff member in parks be the responsible person, legally responsible person in the township for ensuring that we're contracting with the right arborist, with a qualified person, and making sure we're meeting this criteria. Is that right?
Yeah, but I just want to make sure with Casey and Derek for a second, who that would be. Would that be someone like Doreen, or would that be someone like Ken?
No, Ken just does park programming. I mean, since we're only talking about trees on public property, which is township property, the township itself is ultimately responsible. But you could name Doreen or the park superintendent as the, if you need to actually put a name in the spot, the park superintendent would be the primary person to deal with tree maintenance. Although streets does help out, but Doreen would be the most applicable person for that job.
Yeah.
I just wanted to, if I could, suggest that London Grove does it as members of the tree committee are not are appointed. They are not, some of them are representatives of other boards. And I just want to read to you what the ordinance says, because this, the idea of legally responsible, I think, might be a little misleading. So their ordinance, which was accepted, says the tree committee shall be responsible to study, investigate, counsel, and develop and or update annually and administer a written plan for the care, preservation, pruning, planting, replanting, removal, or disposition of, and these are defined, street trees and park trees. Such plan will be reviewed and presented annually to the Board of Supervisors, and upon their acceptance and approval shall constitute the official comprehensive tree plan for London Grove Township. So the extent of their legal responsibility is to present a plan that's approved by the Board of Supervisors. So Okay. That's another way of doing it.
So just to follow up on that, so would you see that development of this plan be the responsibility of the sustainability committee members, or are you expecting it to be developed by Doreen, for example, in the parks team?
I would think it would be more appropriate. I think it would be appropriate for the sustainability committee to develop such a plan. It might be, yeah, it might be that after experience that a specialized tree committee might be beneficial. Because it could draw on expertise, for example, of a certified arborist volunteer. But I think it is it's important that it's important that it includes citizen volunteers, because that's the point of the Arbor Day. It's a point of Tree City, is that this comes from the community.
Yeah, so just to share one last thing. I agree. In the long term, I think that maybe even the Goshen Tree Tenders group would make a great tree commission. I don't, you know, we could talk about that. As far as getting certified as Tree City this year, I want to look at the people who actually like deal with it, you know, like who actually contracted out and who are maintaining the trees and keeping documents of the trees that we plant and the trees we remove. And eventually maybe the sustainability committee would do that. I just don't know that it's, I mean, I don't know. I feel like maybe this year Doreen would be the person to do that and we could change it up. I don't know. That's.
Well, Susan, could you share that ordinance with us, with the board? Can you send that to us, to the board, that ordinance from Lundberg, Lundgrove?
Yeah. Sure.
Can we use it for template?
Do you want me to send that now or after the meeting?
No.
After the meeting.
And the point is that honestly, back in 2018, this was already passed by the board in 2018. You know, Susan and Eunice and I brought this to the board and we had an Arbor Day observance. You know, we were well on our way. We started the process. Basically, I think what the Sustainability Committee wants to do is just follow through with that process this year. We meet the requirements. You know, I think it's going to be kind of a non-issue, but.
Well, if I understand what I'm hearing, it sounds to me as if from all that's been discussed here, we should be able to fill out this application and we would meet those four requirements now. Is that, mm-hmm. Am I correct in that?
Yeah.
It's just a matter of the board saying to the sustainability advisory group, go ahead, just proceed. Is that where we're at right now?
Well, except for, I think the tree ordinance, we'd have to look at that and say, see if there's elements that would need to be added to an ordinance. And I think it would be, you would need to decide whether you want to create a standalone ordinance out of what's already existing or go through a more complicated process, I guess.
Well, again, it sounds to me as if we would comply, maybe with a few minor tweaks in our current ordinances, but we should be able to make this application and get that approved. And this is not something that would be set in stone. We could, as Ashley said, we could at one point declare a tree committee, if that would seem to be the most appropriate path to go, or develop a separate standalone ordinance, if that seemed to be the appropriate place to go. But at this point, it sounds to me as if we would meet all those four standards. It's a matter of just getting on board at this point and deciding to do it.
Mm-hmm.
Hang on, Doug. I mean, I totally support it. I think it's a great idea. I like the overall, you know, effort that would be involved. I think it's a good thing. But my only issue that I'd like to understand is if we're making a demand of township staff time to help get through these, you know, these four criteria. So are we able to steal with pride someone else's plan for London Grove's plan, for example, for this requirement to meet standard number one, and not have to start from scratch with something that might involve folks' time who haven't, you know, planned on being involved with something like this at this point?
I don't think that it's going to require any more staff time.
Okay.
That's the point. I think that staff already meets that, you know what I mean? Like there's so many different places that you can pull from to meet those requirements. And the point is that they already meet those requirements. So I don't think that it would be any more staff time.
Okay. Are we ready for public comments or is there any more board comments?
Just one last comment. If we're going to go ahead and pursue this, who is going to fill out the application?
That's a good question. That's kind of where things were left off in 2018. You know, I think the Sustainability Committee can handle the application. I know that Susan and Melanie is the chair of the Sustainability Committee, Melanie Vile. She and Susan have spoken. Susan's basically said, you know, I can take the lead on this, just to putting the application together. We will need to sign off on the application. That can either come from maybe Casey as the manager, or I think it's probably Casey in the end. It could be a board member, maybe. It might be Sean as the chair of the board. We'd have to look into it, but someone signs off on it. Okay. It's a document, though. It's like a web document that you can have access to. So we could share the password and the login information, and anyone could really look at it. You know, that's in that privileged circle of wanting to look at the application. It's fine.
Okay. So, Ashley, do you want to make a motion tonight, or is this something you is more an informed tonight and then a motion at the January meeting? How do you want to handle it?
Well,
I think
I'm all about pushing
all those authorizations were done prior.
So you think it's already approved, Hugh? Is there any decision here tonight then, or not?
Yeah, I think it's just following up on what was already approved back in 18.
Mm-hmm. But okay. we would like the board to give us the go ahead to sort of.
Yeah, I think asking specifically to give the task to the Sustainability Advisory Committee to get it done.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, so Ashley, do you want to make a formal motion then?
Sure. I would like to make the motion that we allow the Sustainability Advisory Committee to pursue Tree City USA designation for 2021 and handle the application process until further actions needed.
I'll second it.
Thank you. So I have a motion and a second. We've had board discussion. Is there a public comment on this action?
This is Doug. Public comment, please. I would be very much in favor of this. And also, I'd like to see the Sustainability Committee possibly come to planning commission meetings and help me try to save mature trees on these land developments, try to prevent clear cutting, and to strengthen our tree replacement standards, which are in our comprehensive plan from 2019. Thank you.
Thanks, Doug. Any other public comment? Hearing none, so we'll take a roll call vote. Ashley?
Aye.
John?
Aye.
You?
Aye.
Robin?
Aye.
Sean says aye. Thank you, Susan, for your time this evening and helping at least me understand the requirements for Tree City USA designation.
Thank you, Susan.
Thank you for your support.
So I have failed to keep us on track with our agenda. It's now 6:46 and our meeting is only scheduled for 4 or 5 more minutes. So I really don't think we're going to have the opportunity to fully discuss the tax collector responsibilities and compensation or the sign ordinance amendment tonight. Derek and Casey, so we're obviously going to have to earmark time for this at the January 21st meeting.
Yes.
We have a deadline on the board's review and possible adoption of whatever changes we might want to do with respect to the elected tax collector duties and compensation. That deadline is February the 15th. So if at the January meeting we do the necessary review and decision making, we would then presumably need some kind of resolution created and approved ahead of that deadline. So what would that timeline look like for you to create it and get it approved? Signed off.
Well, I can at least I have the last one that was done, I think, in 2013. I can submit that as a template. You have your upcoming February workshop meeting, February 2nd, Groundhog Day. So you're still in advance of the deadline on that night. So you can discuss it on the 19th and then approve it on the February workshop.
if our resolution needs some changes in terms of how we're approaching this, you would have time to draft and get that ready for approval at the second as well, right?
Absolutely correct. Correct.
Is there any board member comment on that approach, given that we have not addressed it tonight?
I'm okay. Comfortable with the approach, John.
Yeah, we're dealing with the time constraint here. So, but at least it's why we decided to have our board meeting. So on the workshop meetings on Tuesday, it allows us not to be confined by time constraints. So looks like that's what we're going to have to do.
Yeah. Well, this is the last Wednesday meeting. As you said, John, we're going to have them on Tuesday starting in February. So
we
will be able to get through our full agendas, hopefully. Apologies to you, Bill, for having to sit through what you have done, but we appreciate it. Hopefully you can attend on the January the 21st regular meeting. Bill.
Bill's on mute.
It's the 19th.
19th, is it?
John, it's the 19th.
Sorry, I said the 21st. I meant Tuesday the 19th.
All right, since we're not going to talk about the tax collector, which is extended conversation, can we at least discuss the side ordinance? I don't think that's going to be a very long conversation. Do you think, Derek?
I mean, I can briefly tell you what it's about. Kristen, Bill, and I sort of got this together after speaking with John. There was some concern specifically about some of the sizes over the last few years of the political signs. They're getting bigger, and there seemed to be a safety concern specifically in the right-of-way, state right-of-way, municipal right-of-way. So the ordinance simply addresses that, the size of the political signs, and the way that it was done was to take the political signs out of the permanent sign language and put it in as a temporary sign, and that way we didn't have to stick with some content neutral requirements, which I can't get into right now what that is, but that's essentially what it is. It's making a political sign a temporary sign in order to be able to limit the size of it. And again, stem from what we considered safety issues in the right of way. This does not apply to private property at all. So that's an important point. It's simply the right of way of West Goshen and PennDOT.
So does Kristen confirm that we can specifically have a language for a political sign as a temporary sign and differentiate it from other signs advertising something?
She thought yes. The short answer is yes. She thought that was an appropriate way to go. A lot of different municipalities do this all over the place. It's not any uniform way people do it. So I'd have to ask her if there's another model around here that does it this way, or if we're the guinea pig, but she came up with the idea, and she felt comfortable with it. I talked to her about it, and she was still comfortable with the approach.
Okay.
And it does exempt the political signs from permits, because temporary signs are technically supposed to have permits. So we exempted the political signs from a permit process, because that would be a nightmare, obviously.
I have one comment to make real quick. Section 2, you have a temporary sign that says exceeding 30 consecutive days. And then in Section 5, you have 45 plus 15 days on a political sign. If you're going to make it a temporary sign, that exceeding 30 consecutive days should be 60, I think. You might check that with your solicitor. Okay?
That's a good point,
yeah.
Hugh.
Other than that, I'm in favor of it.
Okay. So, Derek, you're going to bring this for formal adoption at the January meeting with Kristen present?
I mean, my thought was to talk about it a little bit more in depth tonight in order to bring it to the January 19th. I mean, it's obviously fairly straightforward. So if you're comfortable with that, or if you want to have a little bit more discussion, we can have it for discussion purposes only on January 19th. It's whatever the board is comfortable with. Again, it's a pretty straightforward change. It doesn't affect private property, so I can do that if the board is okay with it.
Why don't you agenda as a discussion item with possible adoption?
Okay.
Well, this is a signed ordinance update. It'll have to be advertised. So you won't.
That's right. Yeah.
Yeah. You won't be able to officially adopt it till.
Is it 30 days?
No. This is.
Seven, right?
It's probably just seven. Our signs, and I'm getting off the field here. If signs are part of the zoning ordinance, I'm at a loss here right now. It'll be 30 days.
Let's just have it on the agenda for January with a full discussion with Kristen.
Yeah, if it's 30, we'll have to wait till March to adopt it. But we're out of the political season right now, so we'll be okay.
Very good. Okay. Last 2 minutes. Is there any public comment tonight? Hearing none. Do we have a motion to adjourn?
I will make the motion to adjourn.
Do I have a second? I'll second it. All in favor of adjournment, please say aye.
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 Thank you, everyone.
Good. Thank you.
Good night.